Okay, guys, let me learn a little bit about you. I understand there are people from many countries. Who are PhD students? Who is not a PhD student? Okay, what are they postdoc the rest or? Okay, who is a biologist? Who is a chemist? Good. Who is a physicist? Okay. Ah, too few physicists. Okay. I'm going to talk physics a little bit. Okay. So, actually, I'm going to do something, mix up a few of my lectures, and one of the lectures I tend to give usually for MBA course, and Danny asked me to give also some kind of, you know, we are dealing with basic science, and we are dealing with applied science. We'll talk about both, and I want to start with the aspect of the applied science. And I want to share with you some of my experience. I started to work in the lab, not as a student. I mean, when I was a student in the end of my bachelor degree, this was exactly 50 years ago. Okay, so I have a lot of perspective. And I'll share with you, I passed through many fields, we'll talk about them, and I can show you that actually all what I learned was very useful at the end. And I think that's a very important lesson, that try to be as broad as possible. Okay, then you can talk with many more people and you can get a lot of insight into many, many people. So the title of the lecture is The Development of Liposomal Drug and Nanodrugs, and I'll talk about both. And we talk about the academic research, via applied research, and then going through the FDA and EMEA, how to improve the products. But first, I'm going to give you some of my secrets for free. Usually, I charge quite a lot of money for my consulting, but I think you are a student, you deserve it for free. You can see here the things we will deal with. I'll talk a little bit what does it mean to get a drug approved. So we are going to talk applied research. I'll give you a little bit of an appetizer that me was a very, very important in pushing me to go and to really put more and more effort into the applied science. This is the surprise. Then I'll tell you a little bit about my experience as entrepreneur and a kind of a user guide. What does it mean? A little bit of my personal experience. And then we'll talk about two systems. One that Avi talked, this will save a lot for me in time. This is a system that, well, Avi was a student on my lab. He was running this project in our lab, and we have a partner in Haifa, a tribologist. Who knows what tribology is? Tribology. This is, you know, what is tribology?
Well, it is science that studies contact and friction.
That's right, the science of friction and contact, exactly. So that's typical to technical schools. That's good. It's typical to technical schools, and we are not dealing with it, although in our daily life, tribology is a major issue when we run, when we walk, when we open and close our eyes, and many other things. And I think this is quite neglected. And Avi talked, I'll show you a small movie we did it that summarizes all what Avi did. And then I'll tell you about Doxil. This is our, actually, our ship flag, the one that we developed, the first nanodrug that approved by the FDA. We'll talk about it. And I'll tell you a little bit of new stuff about Doxil. Doxil keep revealing secrets all the time, actually, all the time, continuously, and I'll tell you about the mechanism of action of Doxil. And we'll see how difficult it is to develop nanodrugs in general. You know, it's 99% failure and more, and we'll go into trying to understand why and if we can do better. And then I'll tell you a little bit of our future, one of our future products, one of many, and I think by this we'll end. So drug development, Okay, this is a kind of a very merciful slide, actually. It tells us that the chance, if we have from every 1,000 compounds that reach testing, namely after all the simple screening and so on, that you decided to do some trial, some kind of animal trial, 5 will make it to advanced clinical trial, and maybe 1 will be approved by the FDA. So if I look at it and don't count all the earlier stage, we talk about 1 per mil success. Okay? Well, you know, still people are trying to do it, and I think all of us should. It is important to deal with it. You have to know that it's very difficult, and you have to find ways how to you can improve the chances to get it approved or to get it to a very, very advanced stage, at least, that from this you can develop something else based on failure. Actually, I don't have time, but Doxil is based on a failure. We did first generation doxorubicin liposome. It failed. The failure was teaching us so much that based on this failure, we developed the Doxil. So failures are not bad if you don't ignore them. If you really use them and learn from them, then you can benefit a lot. So this is a kind of what people agree today that may lead you to improve your success. Well, it's easy to discuss than to do, really. But I think I want to focus on one thing, and this is point 5, which we need a lot of, first of all, by developing system like this, especially if we talk about nanotechnology or liposomal or polymer drug delivery, any of them, complicated system, it's really a very multidisciplinary, and we have to coordinate a lot of efforts, and it's not only us, because there are also other that can help us. These are the people that are supposed to feed us with the money to do the research. It's very expensive. The technology transfer offices in each university and how to deal with EP and a lot of other things. This is on the top of all what we have to do in order really to improve the scientific basis of the... And this is the appetizer I want to tell you about. It was 1991. I was in the middle, or actually in the first stage, we were, Professor Gabizon and myself, the first clinical trial with Doxil. We already started it, and we were 100% busy. And one day, people from hematology came to me in a mission. They asked my secretary, they have to see me. It's very, very important. And they have they told me they have a lady in the hospital. And this lady has AML, a cancer, but she was infected with fungi. They didn't know the fungi, but they treated her. At that time, the best drug was amphotericin B in a micellar form together with bile acid. This is called fungizone. And they said they lose the patient. She will die. They lose her. And if I can help, and they told me, which I knew, that there is a guy in Houston, in Texas, by the name of Gabe Lopez Bernstein, that did a formulation of amphotericin B and liposomes. We know today it's not liposome, but never mind, it's a lipid complex kind of. So, you know, all my lab was fully dedicated to the Doxil in the middle of the trial and so on, but not only they came, the husband of the lady came with them and the 2 sons of the lady, and you sit with them and you know that there is a good chance you can help her. So you cannot say no. But I was not developing amphotericin B. So what I did, I telephoned Lopez and I said, Gabe, I first asked about him, and everyone said, forget, he will not come. He's a very, he always busy, he don't want to come. Anyway, I called him and I said, Gabe, I want you to come Saturday night, bring the amphotericin B with you, the lipid we have, and I'll clean the clean room that we have for the Doxil, we'll empty it, we make it for the drug, we picked him in the airport, and we start working Saturday night. It we made the formulation take about 2 days to make, or even less. And then what we did, you have to do all the QC, and especially the sterility and pyrogenicity studies. Sterility takes two weeks until you get confirmation it's clean. And the patient was really dying, really dying. And now I'll show you the history of the patient. So, well, you can see it very clear. This is the way it was treated. You look at the fever here, and you can see she started getting high fever, and she has a huge kidney toxicity. This is typical to amphotericin B. And you see a fluctuation. She get the drug, it lowered the temperature a little bit, then temperature went up again. And the kidney toxicity become worse and worse. You know, at this range, people are close to death. And actually, they didn't know what to do. You can see here the dose that they gave, okay? And then, this was about the 2 weeks I told you, we start giving her the amphotericin B in the lipid particles. It's called the complex today, and we increase the dose slowly. With amphotericin B, the real dose allowed is about 1 milligram per kilogram, but because the lady was in such a bad shape, they gave 1.5, and that's what made the toxicity even much worse. And you can see parallel to the liposome, you can see the cure of the patient. Okay, and then we treated 23 more people. Actually, I took my daughter that finished high school, and she made all the formulation. She treated 23 people until they start having a commercial ambisome on the market in Adasta. So if you have something like that, you cannot leave drug delivery anymore. You know, you see the things in action, and if you do it yourself and you go and talk with the lady, the end of the story, I went to California to do a tech transfer to the company we transferred Doxil to, and I was showering, and then I got, my wife said, it's a young lady calling you, and she said, she insists that you have to answer, and I went to the phone from the shower, and she said, so-and-so, I don't want to say name, I'm calling you, you cannot believe where I am. I said, where are you? And she said, I'm sitting in a coffee place in Dizengoff Center. Dizengoff Center was the people that all the Shoah people in Tel Aviv sit down and really have coffee at that time. Now it's not a nice place anymore as it used to be. And that was really fantastic to hear that, you know, the lady was recovered. It gave us 5 more good years until she died from the cancer. But the fungal, and then later when we did the analysis, and that's the name of the paper, we discover that actually she has fusarium. Fusarium is a very rare fungal infection. Fusarium is a fungi that live on potato. And normal people never get sick of it. But because her immune system, all the immune system, was so badly collapsed by the amphotericin B, she really failed to protect herself against the fusarium that most people are not really have any problem. So this is a small story before the Doxil. Just now I'll go to the business part and then we'll go to the science. Sometimes I'm doing it the opposite way, but I thought starting with this is, so my lab has many people and we found that quite a few companies doing different things. And we can look at the different projects we are dealing with. Every one of these projects has a different fate. And that's why I have a little bit of knowledge about different ways how to develop from the, I would say, entrepreneur business point of view. So if we talk, first of all, the first thing you have to do is really to have very, very high class science. Without this, you cannot do anything. This is the base of the pyramid. So there is no applied science without good basic science. I started to deal with applied science already after I was a full professor, which means this was about when I was 41 or so. So, you know, I was 10 years of faculty before I started to deal with applied science. So, and I did a lot of basic research on liposomes, and this was very, very helpful. So we're dealing with theoretical aspect and a lot of technology aspect that we have to deal with. Some of them we'll talk during my lecture. So the project, the first one was the first serious one. There were other, but the first that I look upon it as a major breakthrough from our perspective is really cancer therapy. And the first one was Doxil. As I told you, we start with a failure. We work with a small company called Liposome Technology Incorporated. The company was small, and after it succeeded to bring Doxil to the market, it was about 300 people, not as small. But then they were very attractive because Doxil did very good in sales, and they were bought by another bigger drug delivery company called Alza, also in California. Alza is a very, very interesting company. They did a lot of things in drug delivery, but did not do liposomes. So they really bought LTI because of the Doxil. And after a few years, J&J bought Alza again because of the Doxil. And I'm not going to talk about sums of money. These are huge, huge numbers. And I think so this is the way, so now till they have a major problem with the FDA, J&J was the one that sold Doxil, although it was developed by us with LTI together. Then we deal with vaccinology. I'm not going to tell you much about it. I founded a company called Nasvax on this. I was the founder. Now I have very little association with it. But they are still kicking. Then there is a project on inflammatory and autoimmune diseases. I'm not going to talk about it, but you can see it was licensed to a company called Omri, a small company, that later have some problem in the court because of another project, not ours, and we took the project back to us, and a company I founded by the name of Lipocure, that working in the campus, in our Adassa and Karem campus, is now dealing with this project, and they focus on few aspects, including lupus, MS, rheumatoid arthritis, and some other projects, and we'll not talk about it. Infectious disease, we really use antibiotics in liposome, and we really get very nice data. There is project like that I did for Alza, and they actually killed the project when they merged or bought by J&J, unfortunately. Signal transduction is very hot stuff. We are dealing with it in cancer therapy. We combine the anti-cancer drug like doxorubicin with signal transduction molecules like ceramides and getting a better activity. This is in preclinical studies. And we hope in 2 to 3 years to have the first clinical trial done on it. Local anesthetic, it's a fascinating field because pain is a very, very major issue today. And actually many diseases, when you suffer pain, it affects all the cure of the disease. You don't breathe well, you have pressure wounds, there are a lot of other things. So there is a lot of focus on trying to improve pain management. There are two ways to do it. One with opiate, which is through the brain, not a very popular way. FDA doesn't like it at all, and the American Medical Association also hate this way. So local anesthetics so far are very short duration, you know, 2-3 hours, so they don't cover the people very well, and they are toxic, so you cannot give a lot of them. So if you can have a slow-release local anesthetics, you'll have a very, very good contribution to the medical, to the patient and to the medical community. Osteoarthritis, Avi talked about it. I'm just going to rush very fast to it. Then gene delivery, Avi talked about it. I'm not going to tell you my opinion on the field, but I suggest to try other field first. Okay? Environment, I believe liposome have a lot of role for in the environment. We are doing now a very advanced study in cleaning soils at different places, already in a large scale. many, many kilograms of soils with very, very cheap liposomes. And the physics there is fantastic because it's dealing with basic physical forces, how you remove the dirt from the soil. It's really, I love the project, although it's very dirty. Okay, let's talk a little bit about basic versus applied research. So, you know, many years ago, when I started, you know, the reason I started applied science only after I got a full professor is very simple. I like to do it for a long time. If I'll do it before, I will never get full professor. There is no way that my friends that are so jealous of anything you do successful will let you go and become a full professor. So you have to do very good basic science, get your reputation and so on. And actually, I still remember that one day I went to one of the Max Planck and they asked me to give a lecture, and this was the first time that I actually exposed myself as an applied scientist to the scientific community. I gave a title that they couldn't understand what it is, and the head of the institute said, if you would give me the title on applied science, I would not invite you. But after inviting you, I'm very happy I did it. So I think now there is a change, although not enough, but there is a change in the university, you know, in the point that, you know, how to consider a patent. Is it equivalent to paper, less than paper, more than paper? Very difficult consideration. I really like very much the statement of Louis Pasteur that said there is no applied science and basic science, there is good science and bad science, I think. This you always have to remember, I think. But saying this, it's not really correct. I mean, there are big differences. And you cannot, I mean, if you do applied science in the way you do basic science, you will not go anywhere. And we'll go into it in a minute why. So there are very major differences between the two. But that doesn't mean that the applied science have to be bad. It has to be excellent, and it has to be based on a lot of good basic science. So what are the main differences? You know, I work with liposomes since 1964, okay? 1967, I was with Alec Bangham. I learned with him. I did part of my PhD in Cambridge. And I learned a lot from him. And there are very major differences. When we made liposome for basic research, we never care about stability. We never care about scale. We make them in certain ways. Some are good, some are bad. Depend how good an artist you are, because it was much more an art than a science. And today it's not only science, it's technology. Believe me, it's a very extensive technological innovation is involved in making it right. And stability was never an issue because at the end of the experiment, at that time you can throw everything to the sink, including the radioactive stuff, not anymore. So we threw it to the sink. The next day we came, we make the liposome again. And this will never work in applied research. We have to dedicate a lot of effort in making this liposome stable for 2 years. Not very easy mission, and a lot of science involved. Then when you make applied science, you have to deal with some nasty guys. These are the quality assurance guy and the FDA. And they are really, I mean, they are nice people, very knowledgeable, but they really know how to exhaust you completely. They have a lot of regulation that you have to deal with, a lot of paperwork. The way you have to write all the experiments are really crazy. You have to learn it. In basic science now, NIH started to ask for similar things because of all the cheating that was going. They start asking now for notebook with signature, with the same thing, that someone will approve what you did. But in applied, this was from many, many years ago. So it makes your life, in a way, very miserable. Very difficult to educate someone to work under this condition. If you shift from a basic science that many details are not very important, and you know, today we have a lot of problems, and there was a big Nature paper and also Science paper that they said that more than 70% of the papers cannot be repeated. The experiment cannot be repeated. In my lab, with the notebook, there is no way you cannot, unless you have two left hands, there is no way you cannot repeat the experiment. You get the protocol, and even, I mean, I'm taking students from high school to work in the summer to help them, and they can repeat the experiment if they follow the protocols. It's very easy. Then you have another nasty guy that really behind you, and this is the intellectual property issue, the IP, which telling you, keep your mouth shut. You hear the, you go to a very interesting conference, you know you are ahead of these people in many things, but you cannot say it. For us, scientists with huge ego, I mean, what makes us scientists, one of the major things is our ego. Go ahead of us a long, long way. And we try always to sell ourselves, to show how good we are. We have to keep our mouths shut. That's not very easy. IP is a very major issue. We'll talk about it more. Then we have another problem. You know, when we do basic science, we want to do it to the perfect way. I mean, you develop a system, and then you find that if you change this and this a little bit, the system will work better. If you do it with applied science, that means you will never have a product. So at a certain point of time, you have to decide, cut. That's it. From now on, I'm going and I'm doing, and I'm working with it. Maybe second generation, we'll do later. I'll write down the issues and maybe we'll do it. There is no way. So what we say, the system, I mean, they say in the field is that the best may be the enemy of the good, and good is good enough for us. Okay, you have to remember it. Okay, so the other things, and that's a very, very meaningful, that in applied research, the ego should not play a major role. You know, because if it's play a major role, then it will really override all the project. And for many of the scientists, as you say, it's very, very easy to give up, also to collaborate in certain way. And what I'm saying at the end, that to get approval for Doxil today with the new FDA regulation, and I'm taking now, already a few days ago, I took another product to the FDA. It's much more difficult now than it used before. Well, IP is a very major issue. The problem with IP, first of all, it costs a lot of money to have a patent approved in enough country may reach easily $250,000. It's very, very expensive. And also the patent has a clock of 21 years at most. And if you waste this time, later no one will be interested in your patent. So it's very, very difficult issue. We have to remember it. So sometimes you have to keep ourselves even more secretive and try to push the project farther as much as we can apart until we file for a patent. That's actually a very important aspect. Then there are other important things we have to remember. You know, and I learned this experiment. I was consulting to many big pharma companies at different stages of my career. And I can tell you that we believe that we are the only one, we have the best things on the earth and so on. But industry really see a lot of things, and they have many options. So although we think that we are the best, they know many more projects that can be better or equivalent or so on. So we really have to be very shy about this. Scientists usually don't understand the industry and not understand the money people, and that's very, very difficult. The languages are very different. And also, we have to know a lot about competition, and we always, many times we don't have this information, we don't know how to get it. Well, industry know it very well. They have a much better way of getting the information. And we really need two different important things to help us. Really, we need to ask for help from, and not hesitate to ask for help from the TTO or other groups that really have more experience than us. And finally, the secret of really success with industry is when I came to China to teach, the Chinese told me you need three things to succeed. I asked them what they are. They said connection, connection, connection. And I think this is correct. Which means, in the sense that if you approach industry, you have to know who to approach or to find someone that knows how to approach. Otherwise, it's meaningless what you have. And I want you to look at the red things and remember it. This is a very, very important thing. You know, my rule of thumb is that 100% of zero is equal exactly to zero, which means if you don't share and don't get help from other people, the chance that you develop something is really very small. Okay? Because it's so difficult, so multidisciplinary, it's very, very difficult. Okay, now let's see what we have, what the options we have. We develop something, we have start interaction, we want to know what to do, how to go. So there are a few ways we can deal with it. The best way is if big pharma like us. That's rare usually. But if they like us because they have a lot of resources, they can help you with a lot of things. But you have to remember, usually with big pharma, you are one of many. So if the project gets lost interest by them, they will just shelf you and the way to success will be very difficult. A middle-sized pharma may be the best because for them you always will be important. And that's the way we develop the Doxil. The company become dependent on us really, and that's make them supportive and behaving very, very well and so on. So I think this is really a very good way to go. Again, not very difficult to get because they have much less resources than the big pharma and they are much more hesitating to go into a project like that. Then what's most common today, you build a startup. I think it's a terrible way, but I do it a few times because there is no other alternative because you always look for money and it is a very, very difficult way and you are always short in money and you're wasting the IP time and it's really quite a problem. Then there is even a lower level, which is incubator. I know it's in Israel. I know it's in Europe. I know you have incubator in the U.S., Incubator, it's even less money, but we did some project like that. What Avi told you with Mobius is really an incubator. And I think this is the kind of option we have. Sometimes we have a choice. Most times we don't have a choice. Now I'm going to analyze the parties that are involved in anything like that. It's a triangle, a very complicated triangle, because we have the industry or a financial sponsor. For me, for the time being, let's treat it as one. Then we have the university and the TTO as one. And we have us, the scientist. And this is a very, very difficult, a very complex way of relationship because not always we go with the university. Sometimes we prefer to go with the company. Sometimes the company prefer to go with the university. It's a very complicated triangle. You have to be very aware of it, and you have to really open-minded. I mean, sometimes the company will try to kind of bribe you by saying, well, I give you a little bit of consulting, and then let's ignore all the rest, and many people fall into this trap. You have to be very careful about it. So the interests are not the same. Okay? And everyone of the sites have to perform a different task, actually. So if we go to each of the sites, this is the industry, they have to supply first the financial support, and then also being responsible on the clinical trial, on all these aspects, and if they are really good, also sponsor in the development. R&D will be done by the scientist, but the development study should be done. It's much better. They can do it much better than we can. If we go to the TTO, They have to protect us. They have to know how to deal with IP. Most of them don't, unfortunately, although they believe they are. And they have to make sure that the scientists get all his needs from the third party, the industry, or the financial partner. And then they have to maximize the interest of the scientists and the university in a fair way. And that's not always the case. What are our rules? That's a very tough question, of course. But first of all, we have to understand the language of all other parties, all the second parties. We have to help with all the information of the IP. We don't really know how to write IP good. I don't believe scientists can do it right. I think you have to find the right people to do it. It's very tricky, although many scientists believe they do. Later, by the hard way, they discover that that's not the case. You have to be very careful with it, because this is the basic of everything. Intellectual property is a real property. If something serious comes, I can tell you later how important it is. And we have to help really the industry with all the information they need. Sometimes we don't want to do it. We have to keep things a little bit close to our chest, and that's not a good idea. And we have also to know how to interact with the company. So let's analyze my case, okay? We have assumed the R&D company of the university. I was the scientist, and the industry was LTI and the rest of the companies later. And this is a kind of a questionnaire I did to myself, you can see. And actually, TTO failed completely, really. Now they're doing better, but at that time they failed. And I mean, help with financial, bring us kind of money anyway. No, I got all the money for myself. Help on IP issue. Well, I have a very good patent lawyer in the U.S., really a guy that that was a biophysicist, PhD in biophysics, and have a law degree as well as a patent attorney. He did a terrific job. You know, sometimes I wish you will write the paper for me. He did it so well that fantastic. So, I mean, that was good enough to find this guy. That's about the case, and that's very important, of course. So didn't help finding the funding. And in the contractual arrangement, well, to some extent, but you have to be very, very careful, because as I said, the interests are not overlapping. There are quite a lot of different interests, and you have to be very, very careful on this. Otherwise, you find yourself later in a bad situation. They didn't guide me how to keep records, which was very bad. They didn't know how to do it myself, by themselves. And help in presentation or anything. No, luckily enough, I'm not too bad in it, so it was okay, but I think it is a problem. And they didn't criticize, they didn't ask questions, they accept everything I said, which is not very good. So if you look, there are many more no's than yes, but today they will do a little bit better. They have better people, and I don't know how it's in the other places, but I interacted a lot with California and with other places in the U.S. I can tell you, when we have a common patent, they are not better, really. Okay, we'll make 5-minute break. And then we shift to science. Any questions on this part? Yeah. What, student?
Yeah.
Well, I think it's a very difficult question. It's very much dependent. You know, students are highly dependent on publication. So it's very much dependent. You know, if you come to a place, let's say you look for a postdoc job, and you said, you know, I was involved, I don't know if they put you as a kind of a co-inventor or not, but I was involved in 3 patents, but I cannot show you the patents. and then I didn't publish because of this, they will not accept you. Forget about it. So I think, you know, a guy that did a doc seal, that developed a student in my lab that was co-inventor with me on the doc seal, Gilad Aran, now a professor in the Weizmann Institute, he actually came to work in my lab in order to decide if we want to switch from medical school to PhD program. So for him, it doesn't matter. And actually, his publication of the doc seal is the highest citation he will ever get in his life, and he knows it. He knows it. I mean, it's many, many hundred citations. So I think for him it was good, but most of the cases, it's not. So I think for students, I don't know. It really depends what's the relationship, how they... Yeah, it's the same as the young faculty, yeah. So, of course, if he remained in the family and he got, you know, recommendation for one guy to the other that said it's very good, but so and so, and then it's okay. But if he's going everywhere and based on patent, very difficult to get. Also, the rule is not very clear, you know, and I don't know what are many places, although the student work on the patent, since it was not his idea or so on, he's not even inventor. So, and he cannot put it in the thesis for a long time. So, it's. I think in a way it's cruel to put a student on project like that. I will not do it. I'll take technician or postdoc, not student. Myself will not take a student. If I can, sometimes. It just happened that you have an invention during the work. And
so then it's another interesting question. What's the borderline between research that should be done at the university setting versus things that could actually be done? In principle, you say, well, maybe people should do their early stage career at the university, and then if they choose or they have the right platform to do it,
I think what happened, most of us, and also was true for me till I really get much deeper inside it, you know, I didn't understand what a product mean. I mean, in a sense that, you know, there is a lot of things going into it, not talking about money calculation, but for point of view of how to make it in a way that really you can scale up. You know, we always believe we do it, but later we find that's not the case. When we start going into details. So I think what we have to do the following. If I give advice, what is the package you have to come to someone and say that I have an interesting project, please look at it. Okay? I think the first thing is really based on very good science, the first thing. Namely, that scientific, you are very, very solid. You have all the controls, and it's very reproducible. Critical, very reproducible, okay? Then you have to do a kind of, I would call it gross or very general toxicology to see that if you expose the animal to whatever you develop, then for a certain time, the animal will not die. You know, you can do one experiment, prove that it's working wonderful, and then you expose it for a longer time and you find that the animal is dead, okay? So that's very, very important to do. The other thing important to do is that it's not sensitive in terms of stability or if you have a protein in terms of its effect on the activity. It's not sensitive to the process you make it or to the scale-up process. All this you have to reveal. And you have to have some basic QC, basic, to show that you can, let's say you follow a molecule to show that it can be done, you know. Now, once you have it, industry can improve all this dramatically. But they have to see that there is a chance because industry is very lazy, that's one thing, and also they waste, they really, They really hate to start from scratch. So if you come, I have, this is the direction of the essay, HPLC like that. They will do it perfect later, but they see that it's feasible to do all this they need. So the package is actually not the way most scientists think. You know, you have to improve the feasibility, the concept, but you don't have to solve all the mechanisms. Actually, you don't want, because you want to come to the industry and say, you know, guys, I'm giving you this, you develop it, you give me money, I do the research on understanding the MOA, the mechanism of action, which we call MOA, I understand, will come with an answer, this I can do and make better than you, which is correct. You have to find things, and there are many. We have equipment in the university, industry does not have, and they don't want to have. All this you can do, you know, follow things with different methods of imaging and so on. They don't deal with it. They deal later with things that we cannot do at all, okay? They have a much better HPLC system, analytical, with LC mass spec, all this, MRI, all this they can do better than we can do. But there are many things we can do better than them, and this we should keep in our hands. And the other things, although I say you have to be very open with industry, you always have to keep some cards to yourself. So, to some extent, they need you. If not, this world is very cruel. They are not good friends, never. They find a way, they just get rid of you. I mean, they pay you what you supposed by the contract, but... You know, when I decided to develop the doxorubicin liposome, the first generation, I went to actually there were three companies in the U.S. that invited me to give a talk. They all were interested. And I decided to go in two of them, both of them in California. And I went to one company, and this one company said, wow, it's a very nice project. We already injected a few people. They were very interested. And we want to go for it to sign, and we'll give you this and this money up front, and we'll give you consulting, but we don't want you to be involved in the project. Once you give it to us, tech transfer, if we need you, we call you. And if we don't need you, you don't. And then, if it's successful, we give you one for your report where we stand, and if it's successful, okay, well. And the other company said the following, well, we don't have a lot of money, so we'll give you half of the... They didn't say half, they didn't know how much the other will give me, but they proposed half of the... But they said, you sign in the contract that you are obligated 100% of your time to our project. We can wake you any time of the night, all written in the agreement. We can all that invite you. We, of course, will cover all charges and so on. And you will be involved till the project get approval. Okay? So I came back to the university and I said, these are the two offers. What do you think, guys? They said, take the first one. I said, if you want, do it by yourself, guys. Okay? And they cannot do it, of course. So I said, I'm going to take the second one. Thanks God. The other company got bankrupt and failed, so this was tough luck. Good luck for me, for us, for the university. But the second company really did what they promised. They woke me at 2 o'clock at night many nights, say, we have a problem. Well, what can we do? And so on. But we worked together. It was a lot of fun, a lot of fun. You can read some of it, some of the personal things that I wrote in my recent review on the Doxil on 2012. You can see it in.
So based on your experience, what is the importance of brute force versus good science?
What is what?
The importance of brute force, and I will explain what I mean by brute force versus good science in translating something from the bench to the desk.
Well, I think we...
And I'm thinking a product like Doxil, which are quite sophisticated, and maybe a product like Raxan, which are a little bit more
Yeah. Well, I would say, you know, Abaxan is a very different way because the guys developed it, very secretive, they didn't publish, nothing was done, and then one day they got approval and that's it. And this is a nice strategy, I think. I like it. Because if you fail, no one knows about it, and that's good. And they really kept it very secret. I talked with them quite a lot. We become very good friends. So this was a very, very interesting strategy. Much less. That's
still effective.
Yeah. No, I think it's a nice idea, and they succeed to bring it to the market. It's a huge success, I think.
So do you think that it's important to involve early on?
No. Well, it's important. Yeah. Well, I always work with doctors. You know, my philosophy in each of the projects I show you, you know, I don't believe in laymanship to start with. I don't, you know, now I know the physician language, I know a lot about the different concept, a lot about the diseases and so on, but still I'm a layman and I'll be there always. So I always will pick up a collaborator that I'll work with in any of the field, in the immune, in the vaccine I have a partner, in the inflammatory disease I have a partner, and they cannot do without me because they know the disease, they know the things, but, you know, so in all this project, you know, without what we bring to the party, there is nothing there. But without them, I will not be where I am. No question about it. In all the fields, as I said, it's highly multidisciplinary. And because of this, we need many more disciplines. In my group, there are engineers, there are physicists, there are chemists. There are patent people all associated with the work all the time. You have to work as a team. Otherwise, there is a lot of holes. And when you come to industry and you are not mature, you don't have a second choice. Remember this. If you come premature to industry, and you show this kind of things, and that's where you are, they can be very polite, very nice, and they said, well, come to us when you have more data or something like that. They will never approach you again, never. They have so many options, they don't need you. You have to come mature, and for this you need help. So I would not do this, you will not get this help from the industry that you want to approach. I will get it. This is the role of the TTO in the way, to find you a consulting group or a consultant that can help you on this. Okay, let's go to the next stage. Okay, I'm going to talk about, you know, why we are here, what is Doxil and how it is working. So the idea is, everything is so simple, really. It's coming to this very trivial painting that I was sitting with one of my students many, many years ago. And, you know, he asked me what we are planning to do. And I painted this ugly stuff. And I said, we want to do something very simple. We want to shift from this situation to the left to this one on the right, which means, when we give a drug orally or parenterally, the drug usually distributes all over the body. Most of it goes to the places that we don't want it to go, cause toxicity if it's a toxic drug, or have no efficacy if it's a non-toxic drug. Very little will go to the disease. And what we want to do is really try to kind of approach the dream of Paul Ehrlich of the magic bullet approach, getting the drug more concentrated into the disease site. That's actually the whole idea, as simple as that. Of course, we need the drug to be released, we need the drug to do so and so, but first that was, and for this people thought that the only way to do it is to do active targeting. But active targeting was complete failure. It was a complete failure because we could not achieve extravasation. We cannot achieve particles, any kind of particles go out of the blood-fish system until what we discussed, Maeda and Matsumura and Jane at about the same time found what we call now the EPR effect, that it's still a very controversial issue. It reminded me the same controversy we heard before about the proton sponge effect. I'll show you in human that actually we have extensive, at least in some tumor, extensive EPR effect, and it works in ours to our side. But there are tumors I know that you don't have such an EPR, and then the chances that it will work are much poorer. And for this, it will be very good to have an imaging system that can help us to decide which patient to treat with our nanodrugs and which the nanodrugs will not be active. So there are many ways to do targeting. Fortunately, the way that works best is the passive targeting, what we talk about, the vasculature changes, the change in permeability that is dominant in quite many tumors, and also in almost all the inflamed tissue. And we have now many proofs for inflammation, RA, rheumatoid arthritis, EAE, which is a model to MS, cerebral malaria, which is another inflammation of the brain, and recently we got very good results with lupus and some other diseases. All of them we can see drug concentrated in the disease site, in the inflamed site, due to the, in the case of inflammation, it's not EPR, it's only EP. It's only enhanced permeability, but we can see it working very, very clearly. So, you know, I don't know what you heard before, but you know, we have many nanodrugs. All should be obeyed the EPR effect. Why should we work with liposome? So I think you should work with all the system. And I think especially young people can invest a lot of time bringing the other system to the level that liposome are today. I'm too old to deal with this system, so I'm working with liposome because I know a lot about them. I spent big part of my life with them. So I know how to deal with them. I know which liposome will go where and when and how. And I really decided to focus on this. But I think your role, all being young people, is try to bring the other system to the level that liposomes are today. And I'm pretty sure they will do as good as liposomes, maybe even better, if you know and learn to what we know today with the liposome. And we know a lot about it. Just in short, what are the advantages of liposome? And here I tell you a story about a Japanese company, Mitsubishi. They build a research foundation or a research institute for nanotechnology. About 1,000 people work there. Chemists, everyone. 5 years they're working. And then one day the head of the institute said, well, we don't know if this material can do something. Let's test their toxicity. So he tests the toxicity. All the material killed the animals, all one they made. They shut off the institute, fired the people, and that's it. They said, we are not interested anymore in nanotechnology for medicine. That's not the way to work, of course. You have, as I said, you have to do the toxicity together with all the rest. When you develop something, some screening has to be done right away. Okay, so liposomes are biocompatible, they are biodegradable, they are not immunogenic, except some lipid, cardiolipin is immunogenic, some gangliosides, but most of them are not immunogenic. They are familiar, very familiar to the scientific community because they started in the academia, not in the industry. So we know a lot about them. We have a lot of information. They have known pharmacokinetic biodistribution and metabolism, so it's a much easier start. And FDA know about them, so it's a much easier start to deal with than to deal with all the new systems that you have to dedicate a lot of time. The question is, how much we develop from the time that Alec Bangham in 1964 or in 1965, this is experiment. Alec, I work with him. I did, as I told you, part of my PhD. We became very good friends. And one day he gave me this drawing he made a long time ago. this is in his hand painting. He was kind of very artistic, especially photographer. And he gave me his photo. He was in the British Army in 1947. He was in Israel as one of the pathologists in a hospital not far away from here, Tzrifin. And actually, I even took him back to a visit when he came to visit me a few years ago before he died. I took him to see the hospital. And that's what he showed. So the basic idea is that you can encapsulate the things inside. These are the different phases, the lipid actually present. You can see when you start with very concentrated, you can see all the lamellar phase until you get to liposome. You know, Bangam was a very egocentric guy, so he liked to call the liposome Bangazome on his name. And at that time, a young guy in Virginia that I later worked with when I did my first sabbatical, by the name of Wang, that invented the small liposomes, he did sonication and really dealt with them as the macromolecules, called Wang. So Bangam said, I don't like the Wangazome, I only like the Bangazome, you know. And that's the idea, you can see it here, you put it in dialysis bag, so you can remove all the unencapsulated stuff and you live with liposome with the encapsulated stuff inside. And in this experiment, he used radioactive potassium, very easy to follow. And at that time, they were so free with radioactive, with huge, huge amount, really frightening. Today, you know, the people will put you in jail if you work under this condition. But he did many of these experiments. And the question is, how much we develop from there? Basically, I would say on the basic concept, not very much. We do the same things. We do it in different ways, in better ways. We know much more about the physics, about the chemistry, about the biology. But the basic concepts are the same. And we improve on many things otherwise. And Bangam has a dream. He would never want to, never was involved in applied science, but he was actually, toward his end, he developed lung surfactant, so he did involve in applied, but when he was younger, never won, but he supported a lot the people that did, because he was afraid of applied science. So he was supported a lot, and they came to learn from him. So Gregoriadis, for example, and the mentor of Gregoriadis, a British lady, professor, they actually were kind of, not student, but worked with Bangam on the liposome. So he's in a way also the father of the applied liposomes. These are the three gurus, the first leaders you can see here. Bangam to the left, you can see the guy is very weird compared to the other. Papadopoulos, Dimitri, a very great guy, really. I admired him. He's a Greek that worked most of his career in the U.S., and Gregoriadis, a Greek also, that worked most of his career in London, and he was really the first one that pushed to applied research. Unfortunately, Gregoriadis was not the top basic researchers, and this also is obvious from the way that none of his projects mature into something, although he developed a lot of interesting things. Papadopoulos was involved with a lot of projects. Unfortunately, he died young, so it's really, I really very close to him. It was, for me, very traumatic. And Alec died at the age of 92, and he was active almost till a year before his death, and he was really a very special guy. But these are the leaders. Okay. This is a concept map. I don't know if you know what concept map is, but concept map is something I learned from my wife. My wife was on the university staff. She was, her PhD was in science education, and the role was how to maximize teaching science to anyone, okay? And there are a lot of theories about this. I don't want to go into it. But basically, one of the ways to do it is there are two major ways that I'm using in my course. Actually, I bring my wife to teach the first lecture in the course so the student can really work with this. She's doing it much better than I can. And this is a concept map. Concept map means It's a hierarchical way in which you have a project or a subject, and then in hierarchical way you can divide it and you can see the interaction between the different things. Every square like that can be a book. It doesn't matter. But that's a PhD. Here, this is a PhD thesis here. This will be the PhD thesis of developing a system, a drug delivery system, for example. And you can see what is involved. I don't want to go into detail, but in general, the right side is the science and technology, and the left side is the biology, because what you want end up at the end is that at the end you improve the therapeutic index in animal model to a significant level, so you can go farther and do the clinical trial. But I want you to pay attention to this, to this square here. That means a very important strategic decision. And this strategic decision is you have to decide that assuming that you are successful, okay, you remember 1 per mil of success, but assuming you are successful, are the success justify someone to put money on the project? Because in applied science, you don't do it for the fun. Basic science is fun, is a lot of fun. Applied science is a lot of pressure, a lot of pressure. You deadline, you have so many deadlines, you have many people that pay you, you know, you have to report to them and so on. It's really, I can manage all grant authorities and I have, I don't know how many grants, very easy. But the business people, very difficult to manage. They really drill into you, you know, to get what they want. So you have to make a decision here that the benefit you bring with the product, if it's successful, will be big enough. The other things that you have to do, I said that 60% of this success in the project is not a lab work, but it is a brain work. You have to think about it. You have to build models. We're doing a lot of it to see what will fit to what. What kind of drug to take, what kind of delivery, what are the components before you wet your hands, you have to do a lot of these things. Okay, so here you can see what it involves. And that's again the difference between basic and applied research. Okay, we have to develop with the engineering of the formulation. It's based on a lot of scientific knowledge. Okay, we have to deal with the stability optimization, very, very difficult field, very difficult. How to prevent phospholipid from getting hydrolyzed, where acyl esters are very sensitive to acid and base. It's really a very, very tricky way. How to shift the surface pH and the surface potential of the particle to make them more stable and so on. Then you have to develop quality control. When we started Doxil, FDA knew nothing about liposome. There were three companies, and they used one against the other. They asked us, what do you think about the ambisome? What assay to use? We don't know. We gave them lecture. We told them lecture. Now they have a fantastic group of scientists in liposome. Compete with any university. Really top people. Too good. Which means you have to really work hard on them. Then you can see this is actually the hierarchy and the interaction we have. Stability required to develop quality control. You cannot do it with this. And optimization of the carrier also depends on the quality control. And then you have to deal with the quality control with the drug, with the carrier. And this is for every carrier. It doesn't matter. And there are a lot of other parameters. So this critical, this concept map is really critical. Then you have to build the animal model you have to use. People ask me, what about tissue culture? Tissue culture have 2% maximum, even less. If I gave a lecture, you know, today, I don't have time to deal with it, but I'm writing a paper about it because it's a must. It's really a must to the community. Today, the people that do animal experiment under severe pressure and sometimes really threatened by the group of the animal, I don't know how to call them, these people that believe that animals are equal to human, you know, which I think is, I don't want to tell you who else believe in this theory, because I don't think we want to hear it, that put equal human being and animal on the same level. But let's leave it. But because of this, there is a trend to say do much more with the tissue cultures. If we develop doxil based on tissue culture, there will be no doxil. We'll kill it in the second experiment. Why? Who knows why? Doxil does not release drug in tissue culture. It doesn't release. In order to release drug, you have to put ionophore in the solution. Then it will release the drug. You need 500-fold more drug if you put doxil, which means doxil has no efficacy whatsoever in tissue culture. But in the tumor, it has. Because something in the tumor causes it to release the drug. But in the tissue culture, there is nothing. So it's meaningless. And so in many other drugs, in drug carry. Actually, for me, if the system works in vitro, in tissue culture, I will not continue to work with it. It means it has no chance in vivo to work. It means once you inject it, it will release all the drug. Forget about it. Actually, you remember the failure I told you in the beginning? The first generation, we called it, it was oligolamellar liposome with doxorubicin. We call it DOX-OLV. This one released the drug in the tissue culture. It was almost a sufficient free drug. We were very happy. We moved to the animal. We were even successful in the mice. We went to the human and we failed. Why? All the drug was released 2 minutes after the injection. There's no, nothing. So, I mean, the idea is, you know, you think in the opposite way. You believe that release of drug is good. No, it's bad. If it releases in the plasma, nothing, you will have nothing. Well, material sciences, Avi is really good in material sciences. I took Avi because he was engineer. Avi, raise your hand. He's engineer. We have few engineers in our group. He was the student, and I have someone that deal with ultrasound. And I think it was a good kind of grouping because he introduced different way of thinking from our ways, and that was very important. I cannot stand in one place. There is no way. Okay, so how you... I get tired. If I don't walk, I get tired. It's like my dog, you know. When I have it, always run around all my kids 4 times until... When we did 1 kilometer, he did 6. So how to develop a system? Okay, you saw the concept map, and that's really the way. But before it, we have this kind of concept, and we ask ourselves what we want from our system to perform for us. Let's say treatment of metastatic tumor. I'll show you details later. For example, but I can put it in anywhere. Based on this, what property the system has to have, and based on this, the structure and the processing, how to make it. This is a material science approach that is very effective. And this is the only way to deal, to ask first for the performance and go backward and design your system. That's really very critical. I like this method. Okay, now the liposome. Liposome is a huge world. I mean, we have so many variables. We have the composition, the way we make it, the different way to make it, the composition, the size, the lamellarity, the so many things. It's really amazing. That's why I like it so much, because you can get answer to almost anything, which you cannot get with none of the other system, believe me. And I tried emulsion, and I tried micelles, and I tried polymer, and I tried some other system. Never can give the same answer. Avi, I'm right? Okay, he learned it by the hard way. So I think that's really important to know. And I show you a little bit of things. So what, we can define them and classify them by many ways. But let's say we have doxil is in the nano. The nano is a functional definition. It's not up to 100 nanometer. I don't believe in definition that said 100 nanometer is nano and above 100 nanometer. No, it's a functional definition. The membrane of 100 nanometer, the curvature of the inner leaflet and outer leaflet at 100 nanometer become about the same. There is no frustration there at all. If you go lower, and I didn't put the slides because I have already too many slides, if you go lower, there are difference between the inner and the outer layer, and that's defined the nano range. Remember, it's a functional definition. It's very important. So the nano, and it's end up about 100 to 120 nanometer. Then you have many kind of MLVs. You have the multivesicular, vesicles inside vesicle. It's a fantastic system. We use it for our local anesthetic. If I knew that Avi will discuss the MM2, I would discuss the ULALA. Ultra American like abbreviation. You know, one time I got a letter, we developed a shark repellent from the American Navy. Worked fantastic, really. I did movie showing how the sharks really ran away. They really took the project from us, and now we didn't hear anything about it. So the ULALA can hold people on painless for about 48 to 72 hours compared to the 3 hours that you work with the drug by itself. And this is because of this unique structure of liposome that contain liposome inside of different size, a very, very interesting release kinetic, and a huge trap volume. So the huge trap volume is what making the job, you have a very large reservoir. Because in the MLV, you can see the volume, the trap volume is very, very small. It can be 50 times different for the same size. If we compare this and this at the same size, trap volume here will be 50-fold higher than here. And this is the OLV we work with the doxorubicin, the failure that I told you. So I'm going to talk, I just will show you the movie of this, and then we'll talk about doxil and a project that we're working on now related to doxil. But before this, when we design a liposome, okay, we have to decide on what to do. We know the performance, what we want to achieve, let's say, taking advantage of the EPR effect. We know it. Let's say how we do it. So we know that we need the drug to stay in the circulation as long as possible, okay? And then we want them to release the drug in the tissue, in the tumor, and we want it to bring enough drug to the tissue, to the tumor. Otherwise, we have nothing to offer. I mean, so basically, we ask the question, what kind of liposome we need? Are they small or large? And you can see it in general for all local treatment, you know, the best are the large liposome. Why the large are the best? Who knows? Think about physics, very simple physics. They remain on the side, they don't move. The small liposome, if you inject them, they move very fast to the blood. So the large one will not move. Also, if there are other ways to make them even move slower, if you put them into hydrogel, which we do now, so then even the macrophages cannot approach the large vesicle and they stay very long there. Then and any local treatment, MLV or LMVV, so for the local anesthetic, the LMVV, and for the friction for the joint osteoarthritis treatment, we do with the MLV. And then nanoliposome, of course, by definition, will do better for systemic treatment, especially if we want to deal with inflammation and with cancer. Then the question is, what zeta potential? I don't want to answer it. You know the answer probably as good as I am. You know you want nucleic acid, not nucleic acid, and so on. What is the desired size distribution? FDA put a lot of focus on size. I'll talk a little bit about it. It's look like easy, but it's a very, very difficult task to get the size distribution measured right. The release kinetic, it's become critical, and FDA put it, they called, there is a concept that we have, that we're dealing with, which is called in abbreviation, IVIVC. Why I told you about the Navy, now I remember. So one day I got a letter from the Navy, and it said abbreviation end. Abbreviation not. Abbreviation, and I asked them, I mean, I cannot read the letter, sorry. So they said, we'll send you the book of the abbreviation so you understand. I said, no, I don't have time. Just translate for me. And they did. So, you know, the Americans love abbreviation anyway. We also love some of them. So the IVIVC, in vitro and vivo correlation, become a very critical issue in liposomal drug delivery. How you make assays that will be predictive in vitro on the performance in vivo. The IVIVC, very critical aspect. And then we have to worry about what lipid composition. Do we need a steric barrier like the PEG polymer? Not always. What lipid phase we need? And we'll talk about it later. And then we have to deal with the storage medium because we really need stability, long-term stability. Do we need electrolyte or non-electrolyte? And which one you think is preferable? Where are all the people that know a little bit of physics? Which one you select? So the question is which system we have. If we have a system that we don't want to aggregate, and we want to maximize the charges, we'll put a non-electrolyte there, like sucrose. In Doxil, for example, the charge is very, very small, but if we'll not have this charge expressed, when we store it, we start getting aggregation and precipitation, because the counter-ion will really neutralize charge completely, and then once you have aggregation, from time to time, this collision become fertile and they end up with stable aggregation, which you don't want to have. So we put, to maximize small charges, we put sucrose, no charge, no neutralization of charge, and these small charges work to stabilize the system. When we inject it, of course, we don't care anymore, and sucrose is very good. You can put glucose as well. And then you have to deal with which way, what is the pH to keep, and which way you want to inject. And I'm not going to talk about it too much. Now, the drug-related issue, we have a lot of things. I'm not going to talk at least anything about the dynamics. If we want to treat cancer, of course, we check anti-cancer drug or something that will help to treat cancer. So this is not really an issue we'll talk today, which drug to select. You know, we have many kinds, drug that affect the cell throughout all its life cycle, drugs that affect only certain part of the life cycle, and so on. This is another consideration. I'm not going to deal with it. But what I'm going to deal is we have to fit the drug to the method we want to load the liposome with. If we want a passive loading, which means loading during the time we hydrate or we make the liposome, if it's dissolved in the membrane, then we add it to the lipid. If it's a water soluble, we add it to the hydration medium. So that's, of course, very important. Or do we do a remote loading, which means we prepare first the liposome, like in Doxil. The first generation was passive loading, so we have a good comparison. Doxil is active loading, remote loading, with the ammonium sulfate gradient, we talk about a little bit later, and then you can see the remote. So you have to decide which drug to select. Now we screened, we develop a software. There are some publications here that are dealing with it that enable us to check every molecule to see if it fits to remote loading or not, and to what degree it will succeed, and you can define what level of loading you want, and the program will tell you about it. It's based on a lot of physicochemical properties of the molecules, and it's done together with people that do a computation biology. With Amiram Goldblum, I did it together, and there were two students of mine, Danny Zucker, and now Ahuva Theron, that really continued the work, and she did excellent, really superb work on it. And we already screened many data sources and identified quite a few molecules. And some of them we even tried, and these antibiotics. And the last paper showed that the selection worked actually very well for us. So then you have to have questions to find a way how to get rid of the unencapsulated drug. Usually it's not an issue for active loading because the drug loading is highly efficient, close to 100%, but it is a major issue for passive loading where most of the drug remain in the solution. And you have to remove it. So that's drug-related issues are very important. I go to local treatment. I think Avi talked with you about it. I want just to pay attention to this, that actually I probably came late and maybe Avi talked about it, but there is a membrane here and the membrane has pores that have a 250 nanometer size. And so these pores, small particles will leak out very fast. So, and you find them in the blood and many other places. And when you want to treat osteoarthritis, you don't want it to happen. You actually need the particles to be larger. So on top of what all the things Avi told you, you really need the particle to start with to be larger than 250 nanometer. Otherwise, you lose them. So here, that's just a demonstration. What you want to do, treatment of osteoarthritis, will need larger particle, as I told you. Structure MLV, for reasons that we assume in the mechanism. And the method that will make them, simply from what the common knowledge is, will make them by mechanical hydration. I don't want to go into this because Javi talked about it. So I'll just want to show a few things and then I'll show you a short movie. Okay, this is a kind of a way to determine actually the phase behavior of the lipid. So we have a mixture of DMPC and DPPC. We use a DFC, a differential scanning calorimeter, a very powerful, the most accurate, and the absolute method to measure phase transition. And you can see these are the liposome we did. It's a mixture of DPPC and DMPC in one liposome. If we put in the same cell in the calorimeter, we put the two liposomes, you can see that they behave independently. So that's for us really a proof that we got a very good mixture. And you can see here we're 37 degrees here. At the end, right at the end of the transition, so most, this is a very, very interesting point from the physical point of view of the lateral organization, and that's where the membrane is the softer, and that's why it worked the best. On the other end, although it's softer, it tends to stick and interact with the support of the cartilage, and that's very important. If we shift to a much more fluid, like DOPC, which also will be fluid, what we can see is, although at the first time that we did it, we get a very good result. If we repeat the experiment second, third, fourth time, there is no more lipid attached to the cartilage. So it is very important on the top of having the lipid kind of soft that it will tend to stay and associate with the cartilage. So that's what it has to measure. This is the phase diagram, just to show you. We are working with the LD, but close to the SO phase, close to here. Close to the SO phase, here, somewhere here, maybe even in this kind of lens that you see here, and you never want to be in this range. This is the really very difficult coexistence range that many things can happen. You don't want to be there, but you want to be somewhere here. And this is for later, this is the LO phase, which is the most stable phase, not affected by temperature. There is no phase transition there that you get with cholesterol. This is the liquid ordered phase. Here, if we put cholesterol, and I don't know if Avi showed you the results, you actually, cholesterol dehydrate the head group of the phospholipid and the system stop to be efficacious in lowering the friction coefficient. Also, it stopped protecting against the wear, so it's not very active. I want to talk about a little bit another physics is about bulk compressibility. You know, there are many ways to characterize the lipid bilayer. One of them is the compressibility. Compressibility is a fascinating measure, and if we look at the relationship between bulk compressibility and lipid packing at 37 degrees, we can see that actually lipid is even more compressible than water. And this is a plain lipid bilayer. And the plain lipid bilayer is what we have on the cartilage. So that's highly compressible. Respond to the situation. Okay, that's very, very important. Can change the volume, can respond very nicely. And you can see here that micelle, for example, have very low compressibility. You can see the protein has low compressibility. You can see the carbohydrate has a very, very low compressibility. So this is the scale. And if you look at the compressibility, you can see that lipid at the solid ordered phase are not highly compressible. And these are our DMPC. And actually, the DMPC, DPPC, even higher in the compressibility. Just to show you that actually this lipid, if you inject them to the joint of a rabbit, will stay there for a very long time. It's with radioactive, so we know. And this actually was supportive later to the effect that you see in human up to 90 days. And the mechanism Avi talked about. But I want to show you this. I mean, we think we are very clever, but we are really reinventing the wheel all the time. This is the Egyptian. And the Egyptian, everyone wonder how the Egyptian pushed these big stones. Okay? So I want you to check. You see these guys, he's leading a lot of people, and they pushing the big columns from the south that they bring to different places of the country to build their temples. How they do it? People wonder for a long time till they found something in writing. I want you to look at this, and now I'll zoom on it, and you can see what the guy is doing. He's watering the flat area. And this water is what we do with the liposome, basically. We water the surface, and that's why it works so well. And I will show you the nice bearing, but this is a nicer one, actually. The inventor of the bearing was Leonardo da Vinci. And I was teaching in Rome in 2006, I think, in La Sapienza, and they have a special exhibition, and they have the real codex. You know, he wrote things on codexes. Leonardo, when you ask Einstein, who are the genius in the world, he said, Leonardo, da Vinci, Galileo, Newton, and myself. That's what he said, okay? In this order, of course. Leonardo was the first one that really did experiment in a scientific way with protocols. And so I went to this exhibition because I was on the university staff, and they said no cameras, and if you just move near, there was alarms and so on. So I went to the director of the museum, and I said, I need it for students. He said, for what? I need to explain friction. So he opened for me the things, and I could take the photo of it. And he said, don't tell anyone. The Italians are like us, you know. The Italians are really like us. They are really, don't tell anyone, you know. Yeah, that's right. So this is the original, and you can see how he designed it. It's a very, very clever idea, and that's what we have, basically. That's the same that Avi. That's what we have. These are the team. And this was licensed to Mobius, and I think I'll show you the movie now. I think it's a neat. It takes about 1 minute, but it's really a neat one. This I'm showing it to high school. I give a lot of lecture in high school to students, and also now I start giving even to middle school. It's fun, and I hope it will work because it's internet dependent. Okay, now it's without any sound. We didn't have money to have sound, but now we make the sound. I got some money, so I invested in Hebrew because I need it for schools. So, it's very fast. So you can read. Okay, you have the healthy and the osteoarthritis. Okay, this is actually the structure, and you can see the pain. This is the wave of the pain. The patient has suffered because of the abrasive surface. There are very little cartilage there. Okay, the treatment, you inject it here. These are the big liposomes, multilamellar liposomes. You can see them. Okay, see what happened. We believe this is really the case. Just wait, wait. This is the delamination of the liposome. They laminate. They form multi-bilayers on the surface. And we know there are other people that confirm that this actually exists. Now we do also electron microscopy to prove it. But, and you can see this is the hydration of the water molecules. This is the movie. Just show the activity. Okay, another time. And then we switch to the... Kids love it, really. They show, stop, show it again. I mean, the nice thing about this project, that it's very, very simple. The same with the cleaning. Not sophisticated, no targeting, no anything, but it really works in patients. What?
Is it enough?
We'll see.
Because at the end, it doesn't treat inflammation.
No, but it really stays there for a long time. And then you can give anti-inflammatory. It's not a big deal. If you give an anti-inflammatory, the abrasive stays. It takes care on the abrasive, on the main cause. Here you can see very well the... We have experience up to 90 days, one injection. Quite good. Better than hyaluronic acid. Okay. This is the study, so I'm not going to show it. Okay. How tired you are? I can speak up to 5 hours. This is my... regular teaching schedule.
Okay.
Okay, now let's go to doxy a little bit. So that's what we're dealing with. Again, efficacy against toxicity. It's a slide I got from Alberto. I'm very lazy, so for any slides that are not describing work, I'll take anything I can. This is the side effect. All the cancer drugs are very toxic. You can see everything that you want, Doxil is bad to it, except the cancer itself. Actually, it's fantastic drug, was actually in use since 1971. It's still number one first-line drug against broad spectrum of cancer. Nothing competes with it. No biological, no anything. This drug really do the job. But it also do other job we don't want it to do, and that's what we have to deal with it, basically. Okay. There are a few guys that really was very important to what we did. And our advantage is that they didn't use what they discovered, and we did use it. That's a very big difference. I mean, they did a lot of very good scientific work, and we were the first one to take advantage of this scientific work. This is Rakesh Jain. He's a brilliant guy. He's a physicist by profession, and he really introduced the physics into the cancer. You know, physicians are not aware of it, but physics has a lot of importance to cancer. And that's what he said. To improve treatment, researchers need not only to gain better understanding of cancer genetic underpinning, but also consider the physical forces in tumors. And I think if you don't consider it, you simply fail. That is, I think, and he's right. And what we are saying, that you have to consider taking advantage of the today. He talked about physics. I add to it the metabolism of the tumor also, and I'll show you if we have time. both of this aspect. So this is actually one slide I took also from Rakesh Jain. First of all, tumor has a lot of built-in pressure inside, which actually prevent drug from diffuse into the tumor tissue. So not only that it go the same concentration as in other parts of the body, it actually go less, and this was proven. So because of this, and also a lot about the anatomy of the tumor, here there is the data about pressure showing that normal tissue doesn't have such a pressure, and all tumors he tested have this pressure. And this is the other guru of the field. This is Matsumura and Maeda, and they are the one that described the EPR effect, and that's our way to describe the EPR effect from a paper that published in 1986, right when we failed with the first formulation of the liposomal liposomal doxorubicin. Based on this, and on this data, we started to work on the doxil. This was very, very important to us, including the aspect of that you lose a lot of drug once you inject because of the fast drug release. So different calculation, I don't have time to go into it. So basically, tumor has, as you know, lack a lymphatic drainage or have a poor lymphatic drainage, so particles that present there will not disappear very fast. And the other, that the blood capillary are porous, they are not complete, and there are many of them, so particles can leak out. They are not moving by regular diffusion, by other type of movement. And this was proven very nicely, actually, by Rakesh Jain again. And based on this, we thought, and other also, that particle below 100 nanometer will be a good point to start with in the development of the next generation. Jain came in February in a very nice review paper that I like very much in Scientific American because it presents the story very nicely, and he described how blood vessels are dealing with tumor, and he now relate to another point that he himself starting to treat. Unfortunately, it was too toxic, and he said that there is the matrix that this part that really also block movement of molecules. You know, at the beginning we thought, okay, we have porous, so we get more drug, but there are area in the tumor that are blocked because of the highly developed matrix there, very chaotic matrix, and because of this, the things doesn't work well. And he proposed a way, actually, to deal with the matrix, to deal with the collagen, but unfortunately, it caused elevated blood pressures and also other toxicity, so this way now someone has to work on it more and trying to bring it to a kind of a usable stage in the clinic, but I'm sure it will help a lot, and we are working on it too by other means, and I don't have time to go into it. So again, what we're dealing with is the same performance treating metastatic tumor. We need small, almost chargeless, so it will not interact with anything. Actually, we need long circulation, and we need a small unilamellar vesicle that can extravasate from the blood vessels in the tumor. And by this, we need some technique of downsizing, and the best technique at that time was extrusion. And although today you can talk about microfluidics, but I think I played with it. I think it still have a long, long way to go. And still extrusion has many, many advantages, especially on the large scale. What we need is based on what I decided before. First of all, we need huge load of drug because we have small liposome, so the trap volume is very, very small. So if we load by passive way, no way we'll bring enough drug. So we need to develop another sophisticated loading method. This is the ammonium sulfate that I'll tell you about. We need the liposome circulate for very long. So we need a steric barrier. This is the lipopolymer, the PEG, the 2,000 Dalton PEG DSP that we are using, and because of the extravasation, we need the liposome to be small, below 100 nanometer. Doxil is 80 to 90 nanometer. And lipodox is 75 to 85 nanometer. That's about the sizes we have today. I'm going to skip it. I mean, The only thing is that I always was under attack that liposomes are not nanotechnology, so I have to come with answers. And in our school, they said, when they opened, I don't know, 12 years ago or 10 years at the Nano Center, I registered as a member. They said, liposome is not a nanoparticle. We are not accepting you. After 2 years, they sent me a letter. We want you to become a member of honor. You are the only one that have drug on the market. So I said, okay, guys, but you will pay the price for it anyway. So I think we don't have to decide. The biology decide for us. Nanotechnology is... They really find a way to the target. Larger liposome will not, and low molecular weight drug will not, so the nano are really special. There are many other reasons we stop it. The heart of the matter is this loading, and the more we learn on it, the more we find how lucky we are that we developed this method. Because it's enabled excellent loading, stability on the shelf, stability in the plasma, and release of the tumor, all in the same mechanism of loading. It's very simple. In a way, we make a liposome with ammonium sulfate, we remove the ammonium sulfate from the outside, and then what we have, we simply replace the doxorubicin with the ammonium, and it becomes a sulfate salt that precipitates inside the liposome, and in its form gels, and these gels you can measure by many, many methods, cryotherm, X-ray, and many other. I don't have time to talk about it. It's a fascinating field, and I still discovered many new things about it. And later what happens, something in the tumor that I'll tell you about in a little while, will come and do the opposite things, and it will push the doxorubicin outside. When we first look at 1992 with Dan Lassie, he was a great guy. He died very young, 49, really. A pity for science that this brilliant guy died so young. But he has a lot of network of connection, and he found one. We know from other study when I wrote the patent a few years ago, before this, 1988, when we wrote the patent, I knew the doxorubicin is precipitated inside the liposome by many other spectroscopic methods. And I asked Dan if we can find someone to do X-ray diffraction, and he found Macintosh, and we did X-ray diffraction on this. And we found that actually we have crystals of doxorubicin sulfate, and it's not dependent on the ammonium, just on the sulfate, because sodium sulfate and ammonium sulfate in bulk make the same crystals. You can see here the diffraction line of the two are identical, the same one like inside the liposome. All other, we did many, don't have this kind of crystal. Now we do much better with the X-ray, and I can tell you what kind of information we can see. This is a recent study that we're doing with the laboratory of Uri Raviv, work by a new immigrant from France, Yael Schlich, and you can see here very nicely the doxorubicin and all the structure of the membrane, and I translate it into number. We can see the peg, the length of the peg. This is the peg. We can see the bilayer dimension, inside and outside, and we know the peg inside is different from the peg outside. We know it, so it's really very interesting. And we also see the crystals. You can see the dimension of the crystals here. All this we can get from the information. These liposomes are very stable. They don't release drug. Here you can see the first generation doxorubicin that failed. Very fast release of the drug. Here you see very slow. These are variation of lipid composition. So this is the doxyl, the best. This is with another lipid, with ECPC, and here with DPPC. So lipid, this will be an unviable formulation, but still it's much better than here that you get almost an immediate release. And for this we develop what we call dilution release assay, in which we put a pressure of dilution of 10,000 fold and follow the release rate. And this is now a test as part of the IVIVC that show us if to go ahead with the formulation of not. If you get a fat release, forget about it. That's it. Okay, let's ignore it because you are probably very tired. And I don't want to talk about the mechanism of action. It's work on the molecular biology, but really inhibit the DNA DNA replication in two different sites, and one physical and one biochemical. And you can see here, it's very important, every ml of doxil has 2.3 10 in 14 liposome, and every liposome and 10,000 molecules of doxorubicin inside. And you can see the monosamine part of the sugar that is responsible for the remote loading. This is the hydrophobic part, and this is the hydrophilic part. It's an amphipathic molecule, and because of this, it can cross the lipid bilayer in the uncharged form, and then inside it gets charged and gets stuck, binding to the sulfate, and that's what actually makes the crystals. Okay, here you can see the crystals. Later you show much better. In doxil, we know everything you touch is a killer. Everything is important. We optimize, and we know what are the range that we cannot go away from it. I cannot say much about it. You know, it's really a lot trade secret, even not in the patent. So you can see here the crystals of the doxorubicin. You can see the lipid bilayers, and you can see the peg HeLa around that really protect the liposome and enable the long circulation time. And because of this, we get, this is the first clinical trial that we did, Alberto and myself, 1994, published in Cancer Research. That's what I told you. We started it in 1991, took some time to publishing. After all, different issue we have to resolve with patents and so on. But basically, you can see the difference, the same dose, free doxorubicin against doxil. I mean, it's 10,000-fold difference in the area under the curve. And that's allowed the things to reach the tumor. And if you look carefully, first of all, you can see that actually this is experiment done with doxil that we removed the PEG DSP. So it's the same thing, the same drug, the same everything, except it doesn't contain the PEG DSP. And you see the uptake by the macrophage. We call it 100%, whatever it is. And with the doxil, the real doxil, we have only 40%. We can get it to less than this, 10%, but we don't want to do it because otherwise the liposome will circulate for too long. We cannot give a second injection. So we have to be very careful. And this you can see really the proof of the EPR effect. This is a fusion we took from the patient, Alberto took. And you can see patient 6 in the trial, 8 and 14, we have many more. And the patient were injected either first with doxil and then with free doxorubicin or vice versa in a random way. And you can see that always doxil end up with higher concentration in the tumor than the free drug, quite significantly higher. This is just imaging that proved it in Kaposi sarcoma. And you can see here phase 2 trial in which FDA asked, not done by us, done by in the UK. And you can see here that FDA asked to compare not against doxorubicin, because they say doxorubicin is not good enough, but the best drug at that time against ovarian, topotecan, and you can see the doxil is doing, Calyx in Europe doing better. And that's the mechanism, actually. You get a slow leakage in the tumor, and then there is a drug release in the tumor. And what's the mechanism of drug release? So you have a few options. One option is that enzymes will digest the liposome and drug is released. We tested it and other people, Thomas Anderson tested, and this doesn't happen. We also have a control liposome of cisplatin in the same liposomes that actually have no efficacy because the drug stuck and does not release. There is no way to release it except ultrasound. Avi, did you show them the ultrasound? No, why not? Okay, so Avi, when he worked in my lab, actually, the friction was not part of its PhD, but Avi worked on a few different projects not related on the same time. He was a very hard worker, but one thing is we released the drug that he worked, is effect of ultrasound, and actually proved that liposome that does not release drug are not working, but when you force them to release the drug by ultrasound, then they really are efficacious, and this is another field. So you want me to finish?
Yes, I know you can speak for
five hours. No. Five more minutes. No, I want to take that.
But if you can summarize, 3 minutes, that would be
good. So we know this doesn't work. We also know that there is very little interaction with the cell. There are one or two papers that show with microscopy that there is a little bit of liposome in cells. It's fine for the microscopy, but in quantitative amount, it's neglected. It has no meaning. And then we have to look for something else. And what I found is something very interesting. And this is going back to biochemistry. Tumor cells are unique in many cases. They are the most clever cells in our body. There are no other cells can do what tumor cells. Adapt to everything, take advantage of all other cells. So, you know, there is one amino acid, which is the most abundant in human plasma. This is glutamine. Most cells don't know what to do with it, almost all cells. The tumor cells, what they do, they use glutamine in a very specific way, and they remove ammonia from it, 2 moles of ammonia per every mole of glutamine. And if you measure the level of ammonia in tumor cells, it's quite high, 5 millimolars, something like that. And this ammonia will do the back way of the loading and will push doxorubicin out in the tumor, and then will be released there, and will have efficacy. And we studied this process, so I want to show you how biochemistry, which really I neglected for many years, become now a major issue in my lab again. And this is the guy that found a high level of ammonia in the cell in 2010, they are underfinding. And here we can show how all the control that we get the release of the ammonia, the buffer doesn't release, but if we have ammonium bicarbonate, the CO2 really helps a lot the release, and the mechanism I don't have time to tell, Danny will be very upset. And you can see here the mechanism, actually, how ammonia pushed the doxorubicin. It's really the reverse of the loading process. So now we know the mechanism, and I think I finished this study about maybe 6-7 months ago only, so you can see how long it takes me still to finish a lot of mystery, and there are more mystery that I don't have time to talk about. So we actually have all the story of Doxil, and now I'll show you one movie, and then we go home. Or you go home, whatever, I don't know. Or we go to eat, Danny. Is the food good? Is the food worth better than the lecture?
Well, this you'll be judging later.
Okay. If not,
we'll come back.
Yeah, no. Not me.
Doxil is indicated for the treatment of AIDS-related Kaposi's sarcoma.
Let me... Can you increase the... Okay, this is a movie made by Alza, full of mistakes, but still very beautiful. You can see the level between professional movie and amateur movie that I made, but still I think my movie telling more the truth than this one, but still it's a really nice. So this is the blood vessels. You see the white cell and the red cells. The small red points are the doxorubicin molecules, which of course get lost. Now the liposome will come into the picture. Just wait a minute. This is the crystal. This is the peg, the bilayer, the peg. Wrong dimension totally, but never mind.
Thank you.
We need a more dark, but this is the tumor. This is the EPR effect. Okay. Okay, so one thing I want to tell you, you know, they have a lot of mistakes, but one of the things that's important, you know, when the... It's enough. When the doxorubicin, during the remote loading, we use doxorubicin hydrochloride, but the doxorubicin going into the liposome is uncharged. It's leave the chloride behind. When it gets into the liposome, it meets with the sulfate. So we have a salt of two, doxorubicin is monovalent, it has one positive charge, so we have two doxorubicin for one sulfate, and that's what enables us to get the crystals, the nice crystals that I didn't have time to show you because Danny is so cruel to me. Okay, no, he's a good guy. No, he's an excellent guy. So, no, but what I'm saying is because of this, when it goes out, it goes again without the sulfate. And it meets chloride again. So basically, the FDA was very happy because the drug is identical to the drug you give as free doxorubicin, which is the hydrochloride. So the history, the fact that inside the liposome is a different salt, doesn't make any difference. It's just a kind of a local depot for it. And I think it's important to remember. Okay? Thank you very much for your time.
Any questions will be...
Answer the dinner, yeah. Just want you to see, I think this... No, this I never can skip this. I think it's not fair to the people. Doxil, we work on it till it was approved. From the day I filed the patent till the day it was approved was 7.5 years. We have 14 years of patent, which means a lot of money for the company. I don't want to tell you how much, but really a lot. But you can see the teams that were involved, okay? So we have Alberto Lab, my lab. We have the patent. Alberto really did a lot of help, but the patent was ours. And then sequence people, every one of them is a team. Some team are 10, 15 people. This is only the head of the team. I know the name of everyone, but I don't have the place here. And these are all the clinical people. You see the clinical people in Israel we work, and the nurses that help us in the beginning, and then and then Franco Muggia, who was running the first clinical trial in New York. And he has a big team for himself. And Papadopoulos, that I tell you, that really forced me to go into the project. He really said, take it as a challenge. I said, I'm not interested to do applied science. He said, stop talking and come and do something. So he forced me to go into this project, really. And I said, now I'll prove you I can do it. And I proved him.